started some simple calculations that is difficult in the differential equation of graded. In this case, the basic energy will be something like this. So a half of this pi dot square. So this is the actual norm of the derivative. And then plus a kind of kinetic energy, and then you look at this at by this function. So this is so called sometimes. Well, this energy is defined for any smooth map from the real line to end. It's not defined just for gradient trajectories, but this is defined on any. So this is defined. Assume this differential equations as some kind of equation defined on finite energy space. So let me define W12 space of pi R n. What it means so this one is pi R n. And we want this energy. So this is not exactly W12 Rm. We need a little bit more actually extra data. So let me not use W12, just let me define some space of mass that has finite energy. So, what's the effect of this finite energy assumption? So, the effect is that the antinorm of a derivative is finite. So, that means as you go to infinity, the derivative must go to zero. At least, there should be some existing sequence at which the derivative must go to zero. That's one condition. And furthermore, the gradient of this also should go to zero. So that means somehow on this space, what happens is there is subsequence, sequence of points going to infinity, and that image of chi at those points converges to the gradient, the critical point of this function. So roughly, this is the kind of space where we want to regard. So on this space, we want to consider this chi maps to this. Some kind of section of some vector. So we want to regard this as sections of some infinite dimensional vector. So let me denote that vector when there is epsilon, then the space. As you see here, what is this? This is some kind of vector field over chi. So whenever you're given point here, and there is something chi, so this epsilon, the E of chi is roughly what is the spatial vector field, W12 vector. This is the section of star. So this is a vector field along chi. That means it's an element in the section of this Fulgar formula. So this E is going to be this union of all this. So in this regard, this element is a section of this infinite dimensional vector. So all the problems, geometry problems, arise, I mean, all the PDE, nonlinear PDE, arise in geometries, all of this, this kind of structures. You can always look at that equation as some kind of element in the fiber of this vector. This is the case in all the problems arising in this differential equation, differential geometry. This is further. And then, these sections, so let me write this section as epsilon. So I want to denote this as epsilon. And then the solution space, the modular space, on M, let's say, suitable conditions, let's say X, Y, F, theta, Z, can be regarded as a zero set of that vector. This is the basic framework of the study of this kind of equation. But that's not one. How would I want to look at? But instead, I want to look at very simple calculation, which is fundamental in all of these kind of problems. I illustrate this calculation for this most theories, and then I'm going to look at this flow model theories. So here is some basic calculation. Suppose chi satisfies this gradient equation, and assume this energy finite. And then, what happens is they exist two critical points. I assume F most, like simple. I think this is true for more general case, but let's assume F is most. And N is compact, let's say N is compact. This is N most function on. Then there is two critical points of F such that this limit, exists first of all, this negative infinity by half is X. Actually, I use Q and T. And limit of tau over infinity of chi tau is Q. So that's the basic proposition. So what it means, suppose you're given gradient, the solution of this gradient. This solution means it's just local properties. So you don't have a priori, you don't have any control of this behavior of this gradient trajectory as time goes to infinity, a priori. But if you impose this finite energy assumption, this finite energy basically forces this gradient trajectories must converge to a certain critical point. So let's give a proof of this. Okay, so now, on for solutions, here is a for a solution, chi that energy is simplified. This energy, right, in only this solution of this equation, this derivative and this one, this derivative is negative of this gradient of F. So it's norm other thing. So that this energy is reduced to just the integral of negative infinity to infinity of delivery. So this becomes negative infinity to infinity of delta. Okay. So that finite assumption means this is finite. Subsequence of this, there is subsequence, let's say tau ij, such that this chi tau ij converges to some point, let's say x. Of course, if that converges, of course it is greater than relativity. So at this point, that is infinity, we must have this gradient of gf of x infinity should be zero. Because this gradient to vector field is continuous, and we know f is a sure smooth, so this is continuous functions on m. So if this sequence converges, so therefore this gradient. Holds for as a whole family, as you power. the remains to show that indeed this high infinity converges at infinity as powerful. Here comes this so-called expansion as so here we recall. So here comes here is most probably non-degeneracy of critical point at infinity. There is the Mohs lemma, which I didn't, I don't know whether. The basic Mohs lemma is the following. So suppose f is Mohs, and that's its critical point. That's the critical point. That's zero is the critical point of that. And then, this is fundamental lemma, then there exists a coordinate chart by U centered at zero such that these functions near the neighborhood can be written as f at 0 plus some quadratic function aij of xi, where xi, x1, xn are coordinate functions of associated coordinate. So that's the Mohs lemma. This is Mohs lemma. And in addition, actually, if you take the gradient of quadratic functions, then it becomes linear. Right? So in this in addition, the gradient of GF, well, our metric is not precisely the Euclidean metric, but roughly this gradient of this F is almost the same as just the linear the backup here. That is a times x. So a is this Hessian matrix. And this is invertible matrix. This aij is nothing but a Hessian of. That's the basic Mohs lemma. So what I'm trying to say is, using this Mohs lemma, you can see that gradient vector field is almost linear. So this implies this gradient of G F X can be written bounded by some constant C of this x in this chart. On a neighborhood, on this unit. So we can apply this. So now, okay, that's it. So now you can let's apply this Bohr's lemma. Lemma two of this F infinity. I'm going back to the proof of. So, now that our gradient equation is reduced, our gradient equation is reduced to this x star plus a times x vector in this term. So, once on this chart, you will see that on u, we have this differential inequality. Derivative is less than c of x. So, which implies you can see that whenever this x lies in x tau lies in this q. So I do not want to give the full detail of this. So my friend is combining these two subsequence that converges to I tau I j converges to x infinity and this differential inequality is x dot c I tau. Implies that in fact pi decay the distance of pi tau at infinity is less than some constant if negative some constant. This is true for sufficiently tau. So this proves that this proves that proposition. This finishes. So then actually this will be a good exercise. So this is a very good exercise. Okay. So that's one proposition. And that is so. What does this proposition tell you? So what it says, this full modular space that it says, so let me denote this M of F is the set of gradient trajectory with a finite energy. E tau. And what this proposition says, any element must start from one critical point and must end at the other critical. So the proposition implies implies this mf is a natural decomposition of this critical point, let's say pq, critical of f, of m. As I illustrated before, one of the crucial elements in this area is the study of compactness property of this modular space. Okay? So to talk about this compactness of this modular space, you need to sort of estimate this norm of the derivative. Because this is, after all, this is the space of functions. So talk about the space of function, the only tool we know is Arrigel-Ascoli theorem. So to apply the Ascoli-Arrigel theorem, we always need to prove some equicontinuities. And for that, you already need this derivative bound. And it is crucial to have the derivative of the map is bounded. And the starting point of such a study is always the assumption of finite energy. So to study the property of the compactness of this modular space, you have to know the a priori energy. So that's without a priori energy bound for this space, you will not even start this compactness argument. So here comes a priori. Bound for this space. So here is the theorem. And then we have this energy in the modular space. The energy is just the same as the derivative, right? The little norm of this derivative turns out to be always the difference between the value of f chi, let's say negative infinity is p, and positive. Positive infinity is true. So this energy identity tells you that actually this antinomy of derivative is independent of choice of this element chi. As long as this chi starts from the same critical point and ending in the same critical point. Here is the proof. This proof is very simple. But the calculation involving the proof is very important. And this is one of the fundamental calculations. So here it is. All you have to do is just apply the tau, well, by the equations. From the equations, I can replace this. Remember, chi dot is negative of gradient. Dot product of chi dot is negative gradient of gf chi. But by definition of gradient, this is the same as negative df of time evaluated is d time. But before I talk about this, you have to make sure the finite nth assumption, remember, anyhow, this is, so when we talk about this identity, you have to be a little bit careful. And we are assuming this is finite. Okay. And from I, we apply the equations here. So we get this identity. And then we apply the definition of the definition of this gradient and get this equation. Now we want to claim, but this one is the same as infinity of negative d tau d of f tau and d tau. So now we are trying to apply this fundamental theorem of calculus. But here one needs to be careful, right? You cannot directly just apply the fundamental theorem of calculus on this infinite interval. So here you need to somehow some kind of integrability of these quantities. And that's a priori not clear here. So the proof, full proof, should be go through the limiting argument, starting from here. Finite nth assumption allows you to change this the limit of r go to infinity of r negative r. I dot square d tau, and everything you have to change the limit, okay. And then I can just replace this will be the limit of r go to infinity as f chi r negative r. Minus f chi negative. So here comes the convergence statement. Under the finite nth assumption, we prove this gradient the trajectory actually converges. So actually this assumption is that convergence statement I already mentioned. So this one is the same as chi. Negative is here, so this one is chi p. So the importance of this energy estimate is that you it allows you to start this compactness argument. So that's all for most theories. Now I want to go back to this action function. These action functionals, let us define on the covering space of M. Then 1 of h p then we introduce this altimeter. Then we introduce, let's say, the almost complex structures, which is comparable for most complex structure. On the simplex manifold, and comparable means what comparable meant was this bilinear form is a Riemannian metric. That's the definition of a comparability. And once you are given a Riemannian metric on a space, and this naturally induces the altimetric. The altimetric on this, let's say, loop space, that is defined in the following way. So suppose you are given a loop Z, and here is a vector. So that for two vector field along this loop, the vector field along Z is nothing but just the section of this full by tangent bundle over Z. So we define the altimetric, psi 1 and psi 2, J, is going to be the integral of this Gj of psi 1 t, psi 2 t. Okay. So this will play the role of metric in most theories. So we want to find the, now we find the expressions of gradient with respect to that altimetric of this action function. And here is the subtlety. This is supposed to be a backup field. And this is which is a vector field on this actual covering space. But as I mentioned, the tangent space of this loop space and its covering space has a canonical identification. It is a projection, covering projections. And under these covering projections, this p pi naturally induce the tangent space of Zw because it's just covering space. This is a general fact. When you give a covering space, the tangent space of the base can be identified with the tangent space of any. Okay. So we want to find this expression. What would be the expression of gradient? So let's do this calculation. So this is important calculation. So how do you compute this expression of gradient? We just use the definition. So we want to find the pairing of this vector field with another vector field. So let's let psi is a vector field along this gradient of, let me now remove this bracket. So AH at C is also a vector field along Z. So this is also the section of this two by candidate bundles. So here the two people. So to find out the expressions, we consider the pair, compute the pairing with respect to that H metric of gradient of AH from Z of psi of P, at psi of Z. Now, by definition of gradient vector field, this is nothing but the differential of this action function evaluated with this up. This is by definition of gradient. So we define this gradient of AH as L2, the gradient vector field for this L2 metric. So this is just definitions. However, what is this? You remember, this action functional was defined as the antiderivative of action form. So you recall DAH of, actually now I want to go back to W. It's not important, but this one, ZW, you remember this was defined, it has the identity as pi star of action function. And here alpha H, where alpha H is the action form. Defined by, if you pair this with the psi, it is defined as integral of 0 to 1 of omega of this at C, Z dot minus Hamiltonian vector field Z of psi of dt. So action one form was defined as that expression. So this alpha H is a one form on this loop space. You just pull back this one form to the covering space, and then that one form becomes just this differential of action. We define this action form. So this one is the same as pi star of alpha H of Z W. Okay. I identify the tangent space of the loop space and its covering space. So this expression is the same as alpha H. The projection of this GW is just Z. And then I identify, so I will have this, through this identification. Identification of of omega of z dot express this as the end pairing, but omega is not a metric. So to make it, to transform this into the pairing of two vector fields with respect to this end metric, all you have to do is you use, apply Z here. Yeah, that's A to Z. Then Z is up. But by definition of this Riemannian metric, well, how was it defined? This Riemannian metric was defined by omega, and you compose omega and this almost complex structure. So this expression is nothing but of course, this is through the identification. And this is supposed to be this gradient action function is well defined on the covering space. So this gradient a priori a vector field defined on the covering space. But as you can see here from expressions, actually this vector field is invariant, equivalent under the cover definite formation. You see. So you note that, you mark. From these expressions, this greater the vector field on this covering space is invariant on the depth transformation. I And this reflects the fact that our action momentum indeed was defined on the base. And we just pull, and this red vector field sort of is actually, although it is defined as a covering space, it can be pushed down to the base. So that's because this expression does not involve any W here. It's pretty okay. So now, so we are getting gradient vector on this loop space. So just as in the most theories, we'll be interested in the gradient trajectory equation. Okay. So we study gradient trajectory. Of negative gradient. Just as we always look at the negative gradient trajectory for most functions. So what it means, this gradient trajectory should be a path in the loop space. So that means back from R to but, or actually, if you look at the project version, but this difference is not important. So I just but this loop space itself is a map from circle to M. So what this map does is some kind of operator family of loops moving on space M. So this is U, this is M. So that's the picture. So this gradient trajectory of this action functional is going to be a map from the cylinder to M. The ordinary differential equations on this contractor loop space. But if you interpret this equation on M, now this ordinary differential equation becomes finite differential equations. But on M, using that expressions, these equations becomes just this equation, du, dta, plus j times du, dt, minus x, h, of t, of u, tau of t. So the gradient trajectory equations for action functionals turns out to be this first order partial, nonlinear partial differential equations. So here is derivative involved, d power and dp. But this is nonlinear in the sense that xh, Hamiltonian vector, this one is arbitrary function. And you can see that this dependence on u is highly nonlinear. Xh is any function. And j itself also involved j. Expression should be j. Also depends on u power. So the dependence of all these coefficients are highly nonlinear in terms of this variable u. However, this involves only the first derivative. This is sort of first order tensile linear. First order. Other differences. In the integrable case, if you are almost complex structure integrable, like in CN, so there is some standard case. Let's say if you look at this integral, if j is integrable, meaning that this almost complex structure becomes genuine complex structure as in CN. In CN, J0, this almost complex structure can be identified with multiplication by I. By square root of negative 1. CN. And then you can see the similarities. Yeah, if you now you regard u as a complex valued functions, and then this first order part is precisely causally manipulated. So in that case, if u we regard u consider that u from R cross S1 into CN for J equal to this J0. And this equation becomes, you can identify the equation can be identified with this D bar equation, T tau du plus I times du dt, then minus I times sh of t of u tau. So in other words, Cauchy-Riemann operated du minus I times sh of t u tau. So in this integrable case, it is indeed the higher order, the first order part is linear, really genuine linear first order partial differential operator of the Cauchy-Riemann type. And then the rest is zero order nonlinear part. So this one is very good property in the sense that this is so called elliptic nonlinear partial differential equation. The summary. These equations, although I just illustrated this using the integral complex structures, the same ellipticity holds for this general, this total Cauchy-Riemann equation for any almost complex structure. Summary, that equation is this one. equations, other differential equations, with a separate symbol, then of the type the Cauchy Riemann. So what it means, there is a very nice information here. So this is sort of means that there exists a good information here. Just like the gradient trajectory equation. But this is a long story, that the study of this deformation, explanation of this deformation theory is a long story. So I do not want to go into that part, but I want to sort of illustrate you how we can study this compactness story, just like as in this model. I'm going to take the analogy between the calculation ID for the Mohs theories with those calculations in this Cauchy-Riemann. This is a float trajectory equation. And this is a float equation. This is Gromov, yes, the Gromov float equation. And then maybe next lecture I'm going to just talk about some abstract theories, algebraic theory coming out of this equation. So what is it? Again, what is the energy? So the first quantities we should give is more proper energy. That equation involves two parameters, J and H, Hamiltonian and this almost complex. So I'm going to write these energies depending on the J and H of U. And this energy is going to be nothing but 1/2 of R cross S1 of du v tau square with respect to that vector gj plus du dt minus sh du v tau dt. This is exactly the same form as the energy I wrote down. In the most theory, it was just the ordinary integrals, now this is becomes double integrals. Okay? But the form is the same. This corresponds to the time derivative, and this corresponds to the gradient vector. And we always assume the finite energy state. So we are going to, let me denote this W is some mapping space. Let me write this W of this cylinder R cross, let me give you a name. Let me denote let's say theta to be, sigma is R cross S. Then we are going to look at sigma into n. So this is space of maps u and sigma to n such that this energy is pi. Okay. sixth assignment, you go to the equation, the left-hand side of the equation. With k minus h p u as a section of some infinity dimensional vector bundle, again, as a section of some infinity dimensional vector bundle E for W. Okay. And what is the fiber? So you're in your given element here, like EU, is roughly nothing but the section of hookup bundle, hookup handle. Now this time we prove that is manifold by this map U. And this E is nothing but the union of four. So we want to regard this as a vector bundle, and this epsilon, so let me write this epsilon as a section of this vector bundle. And then this modular space and theta of ZH, that is U that satisfies the flow equations. This is the analog of gradient equations with finite energy. So here is the analog of that decomposition theorem. So in most theories, we assume this function is most. So we need to find the analog of non-degeneracy of critical point of action functions. It turns out that non-degeneracy of action functions can be described geometrically. So here is the non-degeneracy. This non-degeneracy depends only on the Hamiltonian. So Hamiltonian H, let's say this is time period Hamiltonian. S is called non-degenerate. Cheapest way of defining this non-degeneracy is the following. If got phi 1, you remember, phi 1 h is a map from m to m, right? So here is your map, m and m, and here is diagonal. The graph of this map will be something like this. And the intersection corresponds to the fixed point of this time of map. Transversality means the tangent space of this graph and the tangent space of this diagonal sum to the total tangent space of this product. I of H, some space of an element. By the way, here is one lemma, we call this a lemma. There is one point correspondence. There is a one point correspondence between the fixed point of this and the solutions, the set of one curve solutions. This is quite clear. By definition, this one curve solution means at time one, this flow comes back to the original point. So there is a time on back fixed that initial condition, and vice versa. Okay. So this here is the proof that is crisp. Correspondence goes like this. But by the being the flow, why is phi 1 h? But by the definitions of this flow, this means this flow is happening at t goes to phi t h x. Let's start with I1, H, inverse of X. Let's take a bit. Okay, this is very important. So what is this? This is a solution, integral curve. The initial condition in the curve of these Hamilton's equations with the initial conditions like that. Okay. I mean, this is I'm talking about in general. So if X is satisfy this, what it means, this curve is period. So this phi 1 h x, the x implies this flow t goes by t h x is 1 period. I'm assuming Hamiltonian is 1 period. So that's important. And the order direction H is one period. Meaning that if you substitute the tip plus one, you will go back to the real. just repeat the same equation. So if initial condition time of that is the same as x, then at time t equal 1, you start the same equation in the same initial condition. You will just repeat. And vice versa. So conversely, if this phi t hx equals phi t plus 1 hx, one period, of course, that means then phi 1 hx is x in particular. So x must be x is a fixed. It's just a total. So this is the non-degeneracy that corresponds to the most property of these functions. Okay, so let me just state this lemma and then I start. And another important, you see here, by this definition of non-degeneracy, if x is non-degenerate, and all the intersection points transverse, right? So in particular, there will be only finite number of fixed points if they are degenerate. If m is compact, we assume m compact. So if m plus m compact, let's say h is one-periodic, let's say non-degenerate, in that sense, then the number of fixed points, the time on that is always finite. Non-degeneracy basically means there is only, you mean just isolated, all the fixed points are isolated. This corresponds to the finite, the only finite number of fixed points of most functions. Okay, so now next time, I do five more. So what was the next thing? We want to declare, yeah? So in most theories, if a function is most functions, and this trajectory has finite energy, and then as you tau go to infinity, that trajectory converges to a critical point. So there are similar analogs. Here is the I mean, this one has another implication, right? So by this one-to-one correspondence, what it means in particular, and so, hence, there are only finite number of one-periodic solutions. I do not distinguish. This is the set of one-periodic solutions. Thank you. remember, this periodic solution corresponds to zero of that action one form. So what that means, there are only finite number of zeros for the action one form. In terms of these action functionals, unless you do not consider these Dirac formations, there are only finite number of critical points of the action function. So there is a whole structure here. What is the basic structure? This will be the basis for the description of this abstract flow theories next time. So the basic so what's the picture? So here is the loop space, okay. And here is the covering space. And there are a finite number of security loops downstairs. If you go back to this differential of action functionals, this depends only on this loop. The critical, the derivative of this has the expressions, if you apply this design, we have now, I mean, the gradient vector field. Down the wave, yeah? Zeros of gradient vector field modulo that transformation. So I'll write this that transformation group gamma. So this is the critical point of these action functionals will be this whole family of this lift of this loop on the loop space. So there is that transformation at gamma. So there is whole family. So when you give one periodic orbit downstairs, then there is all the lift of this orbit by finding this bounding disk, as you mentioned, there are four family of bounding disks, different homotopy classes. So depending on the homotopy classes of bounding disk, the lift will be all different. So this is the case for each periodic orbit. So in this regard, the number of critical points of this action function is infinitely many. Although the number of periodic orbit downstairs is finite. But this infinite number of critical points are not located arbitrarily, but they are located under this group action. This. So we are going, what we are doing, going to do with this action function is some kind of equivalent most theory under this depth transformation. So this, but anyway, this is a complicated story. So next time I try to